been looking at life's toolbox. God gives us tools so that we can manage our lives, and we've been looking at this for about 4 weeks. And today I want to look at Colossians 3, which talks a little bit about how we can go about living lives that are more in touch with God's holiness, who God is, and how we can actually implement that in our lives. And it's a pretty simple concept that we'll be looking at and learning today, but hopefully it'll be something that'll be helpful and powerful for us as we go through our lives, depending on the grace of God every day. I'm in Colossians, the 3rd chapter. And I'd like to read the first 14 verses today. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these things, in these ways, in the life you once lived. But now, you must rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Would you join me in prayer? Father in heaven, these are ways of life that we've seen. We've seen and experienced some of these ourselves, and some of these we've practiced, and some of these are virtues that we need to practice more. We're familiar with this. This is nothing that's new to us. But Lord, I pray that the principles in this passage of Scripture will become part of our daily practice, that we will put off those things that do not belong to this new life, and that we'll put on the things that are more in keeping with who you are and how you'd have us to behave. Lord, pour out your Spirit as I try to explain these things, and above all else, we pray that each of us will hear from you and that we will be empowered to do what you've called us to do. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we all came into this life, I mentioned before, as enemies of God, people who were distant from him. We inherited a sinful nature from Adam, and it passed down through and came upon all of us. And yet it's not just the sin that we inherited, but it's the sins that very soon we began committing. If you've ever raised a child, you know that you did not have to teach that 2-year-old or 3-year-old to lie. You didn't have to teach them to throw temper tantrums and to try to manipulate his parents. You never had to teach them any of those things. It came by nature, and then that nature exhibited itself in behaviors that were contrary to God's word. Paul preached the gospel to pagans, as well as to Jewish people who were familiar with the law, familiar with the Old Testament. And in every case, when someone comes to Christ, they've got habits, they've got practices. We have things that are sinful, that we're in the habit of doing. And Paul's writing this to the church at Colossae to remind them that their life is in Christ, that they no longer are the same old person they used to be. When I came up through high school, there was a song by a Christian contemporary group that couldn't understand all the words, but the title was, "You Gotta Kill the Old Man." Anybody hard rocker growing up, anybody know that song by Petra? Nobody. One of my friends was a Petra fan. "You Gotta Kill the Old Man." You're familiar with that song? Okay, all right. Somebody knows it. It was not talking about some old person who he wanted to kill. The message was, in our lives, we've got these old habits, and we've got to put those things to death, because we're not the person we used to be. Paul, in the letter, second letter to Corinthians, says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things are passed away. All things are becoming new. We put off Adam, where we're born in Adam, and then we come to Christ, and we're supposed to put on the new man that is in relationship to Christ and characterized by him and who he is and what he's done. So he's saying in verse 2, to set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. Verse 3, for you died, the old you died, and now your new life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, you also will appear with him in glory. These things are true now. If you're a Christian, you've trusted in Christ as your Savior, you've followed him, as Jesus said, follow me, to all his disciples. If you've done that, you are already with Christ in the heaven, in positionally. It's as good as done. You're there already. But guess what? You're still here too. We live in this world. And we have this fleshly body that has appetites. We have this life in this old world. The old nature is not gone. It still rises up whenever we let it rise up. And so the message that Paul gives us here is we need to put to death those old things. And we need to put off our old sin. And we need to put on those things that are godly. Now I want to give you a little thing here to help you remember this, okay? Because in some ways we put off an old garment and we put on a new garment. So let me just show you here. I'm going to come over to the toolbox. This is not one of the tools he's given us until we get to the putting on and the putting off. But he warns us about life in this world. And he tells us there are some sins, some habits that we sometimes get into. And that we're supposed to put those things off. And so we have, he starts off with sexual immorality. That can get on us, and that can stain us. And along with that is impurity. Sexual immorality is a very general word. Impurity as well. That, you know, might focus on the thought life. You know, we have impure thoughts that we think about. We have things like lust and teaching a Sunday school class on this once, and the idea, it's not when you notice that a woman's attractive, but it's when you take that second look. And one of the men in the class says, how long could that look be? How long could that first look be? And I thought, that's the most honest statement anybody made during that Sunday school class. But Jesus said, if you look after a woman to lust for her, after her, you've already committed adultery with her in your heart. Why is it that the person isn't committing adultery? Well, probably it's that they don't want to get caught, they don't want to lose their family, a lot of external thing. But the lust in the heart, that's an internal thing, and that makes us dirty just like anything else. There's also evil desires. And that could relate to lust, or it could relate to, some other kind of evil desire. Another sin that is often in our lives is the sin of greed. You want to have more. And sometimes it's not just money. Sometimes it's things that money can buy. But, sometimes that's, we suffer from greed. Another thing that we sometimes get is this anger and rage. Anger and rage, you lose your temper. Now there is a kind of anger that's not sinful, because we know that God is angry at sin every day. The wrath of God is poured out against sin every day. There's also slander. We say things that are intended to hurt someone's reputation or to cause them ill. In a way, it doesn't even matter if it's true or not. Technically, I think slander is supposed to be something that's not true. But, when you share something even that is true, if it's designed to hurt someone, that's certainly not a good thing to do. Other sins of the tongue. Filthy language. Bad words, dirty stories, those sorts of things. In our old life, that was just normal. But in our new life, that has to be gone. Also, falsehood. Lying to each other. All these things are sins of our old life. And they can cause us much grief. Paul writes in verse 5, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to the earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Why is greed idolatry? Because you want that stuff more than you want God. It's like you're worshiping those things. You're sacrificing for them. Why should we get rid of all these things? Because of these, verse 6, the wrath of God is coming. The anger that God has is against sin. And he will punish sin. We read Revelation, we hear that someday he's going to come back. And he's going to throw everything into the lake of fire eventually. Where it will be permanently suffering. Where people will permanently be suffering. At the beginning of the 1,000 years, he threw two guys in there. At the end of the 1,000-year millennium, it says he threw them into the lake of fire where the false prophet and the beast are. So they're still there 1,000 years later, consciously being tormented for their sin. God's wrath is coming onto the world because of these things. Brothers and sisters in Christ, these are the things that God is going to judge. Do we want these things on us? God forbid. We used to walk in these ways, in the life we once lived, but now we have to rid ourselves of all these things. Anger, rage, malice, slander, filthy language, lying. Since you've taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in Christ. Now, There are still a few children in here. As I was putting that stuff on me, I don't know if you thought, that looks like fun. It was fun to do that. There is pleasure in sin for a season. People don't get into drugs because they want to get bound. You know, they want to be under bondage to them. People don't become alcoholics because they want to be in bondage to alcohol. People don't become murderers or anything else because they want to be taken over by it. It starts out as fun. The decisions that led to those sins start out as fun. There's a period of time where there's pleasure, but it always ends up costing us more than we even planned. It captures us. So kids, don't try this at home. It was fun, but that fun would only last a little while. Can you imagine your embarrassment if you came into church wearing this shirt with all these stains? I always worry when I wear white that I don't spill a little coffee on myself during Sunday school. But, you know, because it's embarrassing to have these stains. And even, you know, even if it wasn't church, if it was at you know, somewhere else, it would be embarrassing to be out dressed like this. But not all of our sins are this obvious, are they? At least not openly. I have a friend who had a sin that was very apparent. He was extremely overweight. And when somebody would call him on it and say, you know, you're obviously indulging too much, you're obese, he would say, not all sins are as visible as mine. Now, he wasn't saying, I have my sin, you have yours, so leave me alone. He was not saying that. He just meant, we all do have our sins. Some of them are obvious, some of them are not as obvious. But he was working on it. Turns out he discovered after some time that one of the times when his behavior got the better of him was in the middle of the night, he would wake up. And in the grogginess of half awake, he would consume inordinate amounts of food. And not that he made an excuse for himself, but he said, that's when my bad behavior happens. So he was able to get a CPAP machine, he had apnea, and he was able to sleep through the night so that his practice, he'd be more protected from that practice. Not all sins are as obvious, but all of them do need a putting off, a getting rid of those things. Sometimes we struggle with sin over and over again. Think about maybe in your life, maybe you've had this sin that you've struggled with. Maybe it's flare-ups of temper. Maybe it's impure thoughts. Maybe it's gluttony. I don't know. This week, I went to a seminar, and it was on all these issues that are facing the church and how to protect the church from lawsuits against the use of the building. Say, if a couple wants to use the building that is now legal to get married, but not in all states. That was the issue. And so we talked about legality, how to keep the church safe. In the afternoon, we talked about how to reach out to people who were struggling with sins related to that. But one of the things that my boss, our district superintendent, did is he waited till after lunch to talk about gluttony. Now, I went out. The guy sitting next to me said, hey, you want to go out? And I went out to the Chinese buffet for the first time since my wife was diagnosed with celiacs and has to be careful about whether she gets any cross-contamination with wheat. So, first time since that I was at a Chinese buffet, and it was a good one. And the first plate was all vegetables and fruit. The second, third, and a half a fourth plate Those were the other things. And then we got back and he talks about gluttony. You don't have to be real heavy to be a glutton, do you? You can be, nor I used to be thin. I used to weigh 135, 140 when I was first married. But I was just as much a glutton then as I occasionally am now. But the thing we need to do is you can't just put off something. You have to replace it with something good. Does that make sense? Let me just help you think through something. I want you to imagine for a minute a big gray elephant. Big bull elephant. And he is wearing a pink frilly tutu. Okay? Now, I've just impacted your mind. Some people ask, you know, do you think Satan can put thoughts into your mind? That question comes up. And I think he can. And I just put a thought into your mind, so I'm not Satan. But I'm sure they're not even as powerful as he is. But I can put a thought into your mind. Big, gray elephant, pink tutu all around. Now, he doesn't have big ears, he can't fly, so I'm not paying Disney any money for this royalty on this idea. But right now, I want you to stop thinking about that big elephant with the pink tutu. Are some of you still thinking about it? Right now, are you thinking about that gray elephant with the pink tutu? I bet some of you are. We can't just get rid of something. We have to replace it with something else. Does that make sense? You put off the old and you put on the new. I'm going to I'm getting a little uncomfortable in my messy shirt. So I'm going to put off my old and put on a new. It's a little better. All right. This is what Jesus does for us. Look at verse 9. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. How do we do this? How do we put off the old and put on the new? Well, we have all those old habits that used to be our existence. And yet we're clothed with righteousness in Jesus Christ. It is not our righteousness. It's the righteousness that God gives us. One of the things that is so easy to have happen is when we come into the church, we come into God's family, we find out how everybody else lives. And we try to line up with that. Whereas we used to swear or something like that, we find out, oh man, none of the people here use those words. And so we clean that up. Or we find out whatever it could be. There's a real danger in trying to clean ourselves up. Because this new life isn't something that we put on ourselves. It's something that God does in and through us. He cleans us up. Before we were Christians, a lot of us were pretty good people. And we knew how to behave. We were moral. So, you know, a lot of people are good examples of pretty moral people, but they don't know Jesus at all. In the Old Testament, and even in Jesus' day, the Pharisees and such would try to follow all the rules. And on the outside, they look clean. But Jesus said, you know, you guys, you're whitewashed tombs. You clean the outside of the cup, but you don't clean the inside. And you're like whitewashed tombs. It looks white and painted on the outside, but inside it's full of death. We don't want to be people who just try to put it on as if it's a behavior we're learning. It's something we have to do by the grace of God. We're not saved by works. We're saved through faith, by grace. We're not sanctified by works either. You know, you could discipline yourself to stop lying and to stop falsehood and all those things. But if it's not coming from God changing your heart so that your life is different and it flows out of you, it will still not have the blessing of God. In Isaiah 64, it talks about all of our righteous deeds. All of your righteous deeds and my righteous deeds, the ones we do in our own strength, those are like filthy rags. It's only when we're clothed with Christ's righteousness that God is in it and that he is blessed by it. So we do it by faith. We do it by God's grace. But we do have to replace our behaviors. If you could turn back a few pages to Ephesians chapter 4, Paul writes to the church at Ephesus along these similar lines. And this is set up in a very good example. Look at verse 22, Ephesians 4:22. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its evil desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor. You see there, you've got the example of putting off one thing and putting on the opposite. Put off falsehood. Stop lying. What are you going to do instead? Tell the truth. Verse 26, in your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. Don't give the devil a foothold. Instead of anger, you're going to have to put on forgiveness and grace. Verse 28, he who has been stealing must steal no longer. So if there's a thief, he's in the habit of stealing, he's got to quit that. But he can't just do nothing. He's got to do something right. In other words, he must work, doing something useful with his own hands so that he must have something to share with those in need. So you're taking away a negative, stealing from other people, and you're putting on a positive, actually not just taking care of yourself, but even a step further of sharing. Instead of taking from people, you're going to share and give to people. It's 29. Don't let anything unwholesome come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs. So instead of tearing down with your mouth, you're going to build up. Very simple process, a simple idea, a simple concept. Hopefully, all of us will remember this concept and be able to put it into practice. What about you? You know, if our sins were obvious, if when we came to church we wore our sins like this on our sleeves, we'd be pretty embarrassed, wouldn't we? Some of us have been fighting over the same sins for 2 years, 5 years, 20 years, on and on again. If there's something that comes to mind when I say that, something you've been fighting for a long time, put that off and put on something else. Think about what that sin is. What is the nature of that sin in your mind? Work through it. And then ask God to show you, what is the opposite virtue that I need to put on. You can't just not think about elephants with pink tights or pink tutus. You've got to think about something positive, something true, something good. In Colossians 3, he said, we're putting on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge, in the image of its creator. We need to know the truth about God. What his holiness is. What constitutes that? When is God like that? What are some examples of Christians or people in the Bible who exhibited the positive thing? What do I need to know about that in order to grasp hold of that and lean into that? We can't do it without knowledge of who God is, what he teaches. We need to do it based on that knowledge. And that knowledge, when it's not just in our heads, but it's in our heart, will overflow into righteous acts. Would you join me in prayer? Father in heaven, you are a gracious God. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your truth. We thank you for the principle that we have, that we can put aside our sinfulness and replace it with your righteousness. We do this by faith, not because of something that we're going to work ourselves into, but that you're going to work in and through us. And we pray that you do that over and over again. In Jesus' name.